Martin North, John Adams, in the interest of the people. Hello, John. Well, there we go. It's going to happen.
It is going to happen. Extraordinary speech from the RBA governor last night at the Australian Business Economist annual dinner. He gave a speech about unconventional monetary policy. And he basically, you know, we'll go through a lot of detail, but at the end of the question and answer session, he was pressed about what happens if the world falls in. He said, all options are on the table. And all those options is everything we've been saying, you know, last year, including this year. It's the war on cash. It's the negative interest rates. It's the quantitative easing. It's moving monetary policy to extreme ends, and obviously going into uncharted territory, both in terms of Australian history, but also potentially global history as well.
Yeah, and it's quite interesting because a number of the reports that came through after that basically sort of downplayed that perspective, saying, oh, it's unlikely that he's going to do QE and negative interest rates and things, right? But at the end of it, you're right. The speech basically left all the doors open.
Yeah, and one of the things I was shocked with, and we had a conversation straight after in terms of the speech and the Q&A, in the speech he said this is our preferred model for unconventional monetary policy, which is quantitative easing. But then when he was pushed at the end, well, what happens if things become more dire? Well, we will have to consider everything. It was like, well, why did you give the speech in the first place?
Yes, I have a feeling they're making it up as they go along, frankly. I don't think there's a lot of deep scientific thought behind it. That's my personal view.
So it's interesting. There was a lot that was said in the speech, and there was a lot of things that were unsaid, and a lot of those things were unsaid. I mean, look, there's a lot of technical detail that the RBA hasn't put on the table, and one would expect that they haven't fully thought through those implications, but we'll get to that later in today's conversation.
Well, I guess it's worth saying, John, that the stuff we've been talking about for more than a year now, right, and people thought we were a bit nutty when we started talking about this stuff, it's coming true.
Absolutely, absolutely. The thing is, all the things that we've been warning about and all the economic and social ramifications that come from all of this extreme monetary policy, it is going to be unleashed on the public, starting 2020. I mean, we'll get to this. I mean, the RBA governor said that QE will start when interest rates get to quarter of a percent. Well, Westpac came out this afternoon and said that 0.25% will likely come in June of 2020, and quantitative easing will start by about July, August of next year. So we are less than 12 months away from the great monetary experiment. And again, lot of unanswered questions and no accountability. Parliament will do nothing to ask the tough questions to potentially stop any of this policy from happening. And just to go back to our last show is when I said the economic emperor will crush you. Unaccountable central banker pushing extreme policy, no tough questions, no accountability, he can't be sacked. Frydenberg as the treasurer is completely weak and helpless. And, whether the Australian people want this or not, it's coming, and people will just have to suck it up and just suffer the consequences.
Yeah, and just before we get into the detail, I also think it's very interesting that he gave a spin to quantitative easing around the world, and I think was saying it was much more successful than many people would claim it's been. Look at Japan, look at the US, look at Europe.
Yes. I mean, look, he said there was benefits to unconventional monetary policy. He did say there were some side effects and some negative things also. But on the key question of QE, he said, he did make the point that, central banks around the world, when they start QE, they haven't to date been able to unwind it. And the key thing that was missing in his speech was, well, if we're going to do QE in Australia, how do they unwind this balance sheet? Well, he didn't even answer that. And the reality is he can't.
No, it's a one-way escalator to somewhere very scary.
Absolutely.
Well, let's go into some of the thematics that came through in his speech, because I think people need to understand this in some detail to really get into the vibe as to what this means.
I think the first thing to note, Martin, is that the governor said that we are in a low interest rate environment, and this is not temporary. This is going to be sustained going forward. There's a few points to say about this. The first thing is to say that it's something I wrote several years ago. They can't raise interest rates. And the reason why they can't is that because the debt bubble in this country is so big that if they raise interest rates, people would default and we would have a deep recession slash depression. And you know, going, and we'll get to this in a future post. I mean, what caused the Irish housing crisis? They had a big bubble in some metrics bigger than ours, and other metrics were bigger than theirs. But from 2005 through to 2007, interest rates effectively doubled in Ireland, driven by the European Central Bank. And so when you've got a big debt bubble, if you drive those interest rates up and the debt servicing costs increase, at some point someone's going to say they can't pay, and then you're going to have a huge financial crisis. So they're trying to avoid that situation, and that's why they've effectively said that they can't raise interest rates, and that's why we're going to be in this low rate environment moving forward. But the other thing he said was that about this subdued growth, he basically made the point that the world has too much savings. And we need to find a way, not only in Australia but around the world, there needs to be a way to get these savings out of the banks and into the productive part of the economy to actually boost global economic growth. Now, extraordinary and stupid statement. Now, according to the International Institute for Finance, which is the leading organization in Washington, D.C. that looks at global debt, for the end of June 2019, global debt was at 250 trillion or 300% of GDP. So these are the metrics I use to make the claim this is the biggest debt bubble in the history of the world. We've never had debt at this level of quarter of $1 trillion or at 320% of global GDP. And he says that the issue is not too much debt, the issue is too much savings. I mean, again, Keynesian nonsense that permeates right throughout the RBA, and this guy is completely out of touch with reality.
Well, it's clear, I think, that the reason there is that savings is because debt has really accelerated, right? Because, of course, every time debt goes up, it creates an asset, and that asset then can be effectively savings. But the root cause is the debt, not the savings.
Exactly.
Right? And, of course, it's worth thinking, John, that a year ago, the Reserve Bank was expecting rates to go up. The Fed was expecting rates to go up. And so, effectively, we were at that stage in an environment where the expectation was that interest rates would indeed go higher. But, effectively, what's happened is that the markets have won. And essentially now the central banks are being forced to take rates lower and lower and lower.
Yes. I mean, yeah, look, last year the RBA governor was saying that interest rates were likely more to go up than rates go down. And then once you started to see some tightening in 2018, you saw particularly the US stock market, that was sort of falling off a cliff in the last quarter of 2018. And that's where Jerome Powell took a course correction and said, okay, well, we're going to put interest rate increases on hold. And then they started cutting interest rates. And obviously central banks around the world have taken the lead from the Americans. And we're now, we're now in a mad rush to cut rates. But obviously, one of the points we've made throughout 2019 is that we don't have a lot of runway left, and we're already at 0.75%. And particularly if we have a huge hiccup, we don't have much runway to cut.
Indeed. Well, let's talk about the four unconventional policies that he basically went through, which, by the way, was also in that BIS paper that came out quite recently too.
Yes. So there was a Bank for International Settlements paper that looked at international evidence around unconventional monetary policy. So that paper looked at four forms of unconventional monetary policy. One was negative interest rates, extended liquidity operations, but in terms of what's happening in the repo market now, trying to keep markets smooth and functional and operational if there's any issues with liquidity, quantitative easing. What I would call debt monetization. And the last one is in terms of forward guidance. So forward guidance is basically where a central bank makes some statements about what is going to happen in the future. And those statements shape expectations of certain economic agents in the market. And that change of expectations can actually have an impact on economic outcomes like unemployment, economic growth, inflation, etc. So that's what forward guidance is. So basically, these are the four things that were reviewed. The governor made a series of points about each one. And obviously, we'll put a link to in terms of where you can find it on the RBA website. So a few things to point out. These measures did bring some benefits. What the governor basically said was that these unconventional measures, and some of them have been used in different ways across the world. basically said, you know, it was effective in keeping market rates, credit markets, and the financial and banking system, you know, operating quite smoothly. Everything was still functional. There was no liquidity problems. There was no sort of shortages anywhere. And basically, these measures, particularly QE, was successful in bringing down the risk-free interest rate. And by bringing down the risk-free rate, the risk-free rate is basically the rate in which other interest rates are set right throughout the economy. And by bringing those rates down, they were able to bring asset prices up and lower the exchange rate. Now, one of the things we've been criticizing is that we don't want asset prices up because we already have an unsustainable bubble. And he basically said that, no, the purpose of these policies is to drive asset prices higher because of what John Maynard Keynes talked about in terms of the wealth effect. If you feel more wealthier, you are more likely to go out and spend. Central bank economists and you know, treasury officials, etc. They think that that's the way to run an economy, by artificially boosting asset prices, deluding people to thinking that they're rich so that they'll go out and spend. And that's just a merry-go-round of debt consumption, up until the point that it becomes a systemic crisis, and then we have basically the economic Armageddon scenario that I've been warning about for years.
It's worth saying, John, that he did also say that QE basically was used at the crisis, the GFC, right? So essentially, that was the trigger for these policies. In other words, this wasn't business as usual. This was in reaction to a significant international financial crisis.
Yeah, Martin. So I think there's a few points to make on that. So he did say that QE has been used historically prior to in terms of the GFC, but during the GFC it was used at a scale never before seen in world history. And one of the points that he did make was that when you look at the in terms of major central bank balance sheets, the amount of securities, whether it's the private sector or government securities, on the balance sheets was about 5% of GDP prior to the GFC. Now it's about, on average, 30%. If you look at the Bank of Japan balance sheet, they own about 50% of all government debt. And the point he did make was that they have not found a way to unwind this. Mm. And yet he says he's going to do it. And he hasn't provided a solution of how to unwind all of these bonds if he was to go out and buy them.
And we are not, according to the Reserve Bank, in a crisis. Right. He's still saying he thinks the economy is going to recover, that we're going to see wages growth, we're going to see inflation start to rise, which then begs the question, well, why on earth would you do QE anyway?
Precisely. So now, in terms of unintended consequences, he was willing to call some of them out. So we'll just go through some of them. He did say that some of these policy measures changed the economic incentives, which were unhelpful in boosting economic growth. It did create an inaction bias towards economic reform. And basically he said there's too much reliance on monetary policy and there's other things that have to be done to actually drive economic growth, including fiscal policy, including microeconomic reform. And he said, monetary policy can't do everything can't do everything in terms of the solution. He did say that negative interest rates, particularly in the European context, did damage bank profitability because they can't get a sufficient spread in order to make a profit between what they borrow from the central bank and what they can lend out into the market. And then he did say that uncommercial firms are allowed to exist for longer. And some of these firms are called zombie firms. So there's a whole bunch of firms out there, particularly in China as well as the United States, that have unsound business model that in a lot of cases they can't pay their creditors or even pay the interest to their creditors. And Tesla could be an example, Netflix could be another example. There's a few others like that. And by having these unconventional monetary policies, you allow these firms to continue for longer. And that actually means that there's an inefficient allocation of resources, rather than actually saying to these firms, you go bust and we'll actually allocate capital and talent and entrepreneurship to ventures that are more profitable.
And it's worth saying that he missed one of the other unintended consequences, which actually is in the BIS paper and other papers too, and that is that banks may well be less likely to lend than in normal situations because of the narrow margins, but they're still trying to make a profit. So what they do is they actually go into more risky areas of speculation, and that's, for example, into derivatives and into bond trading and those things to try and keep their profitability up in a low interest rate environment. So that's another factor which is worth thinking about in the context of what happens if we do this.
Sorry, one other point that I didn't make that I should make is another unintended consequence is that, sometimes by doing these extreme forms of monetary policy, it actually has a negative impact on confidence. So that was one of the things that he said, that, if some of these policies are rolled out and communicated in the wrong way, people may get scared, and you may have people who are less likely to borrow, less likely to consume, less likely to invest, and then these policies become counterproductive.
Yeah, and he also made the comment, which I thought was quite interesting, that so far the theoretical view was that people would hoard cash, so they'd pull money out of the banks and just hold it, right? Although actually they haven't seen much evidence of that so far.
Yes. So he said there's limited evidence around cash hoarding, and obviously all of the work we've done around the cash ban has been about this issue around having the freedom to hoard cash if you want to hoard cash. Now, particularly in the European context, and we should do a post on this soon, where the commercial banks have implemented negative interest rates on retail customers, this has been a very high threshold. More than $1 million, I think, in Germany, and I think the Danish banks have now taken it down to 100,000. But once you get into lower levels, when you start to impact more customers, that's when you probably see more evidence of cash hoarding, but so far he says that there's limited evidence that that has happened.
Well, he's wrong. So there was a German bank a week ago who said that they were going to start charging for the first dollar.
For the first dollar?
Yeah.
For all customers?
Correct.
Wow. Okay. So has that happened yet?
It was announced last week. I did a post on it at the weekend, and I believe it's coming in pretty much straight away.
Well, yes. So we could see new evidence around cash hoarding, which obviously means that that stopping the cash ban is more important than ever.
Absolutely, yeah. So let's take the conversation a bit further then. I think that what he said was that quantitative easing really wasn't his preferred option, right? And I think it goes back to the point we made earlier on, that he's saying, well, actually, the economy's pretty good, so probably we'll get away without any major QE because the economy is going to grow and we're going to see inflation begin to move up and everything's going to be fine again. So the glass half full basically suggests that this is not his most pressing case.
Yes. He said his most central scenario is that economic growth will lift, unemployment will fall, and we'll see wages growth, and we'll see inflation going through 2020 into 2021. And if that was to happen, there'd be no need for QE. But he did say that if the economy did go in the opposite direction and the central bank's inflation and unemployment objectives were not met, he is ready to implement QE. And obviously, by virtue of Westpac this afternoon coming out and saying by July, August next year, QE started, these forecasts put out by the RBA, which have consistently been wrong for years about wages growth, about unemployment, about economic growth, Westpac is calling BS on those forecasts and they're saying, well, you better put your seatbelt on. QE is about to sort of get ready in the second half of 2020.
Right. And, his view was that the 0.25% is the zero level effectively because of the way that the interbank lending goes. So at that level, you would effectively be at zero interest rates, and that means that post that, then QE would follow.
Precisely. So we're at 0.75% now. The market is priced in a rate cut for February, and that will take us to 0.5%. Westpac thinks that we'll get to 0.25% by June. And then QE will start after that. So again, everyone is saying that interest rate cuts are coming into 2020. And like the governor said, once you hit a quarter of a percent, if unemployment is too high, if inflation is too low, they're going to start QE. And again, the point to be made, let's spend a second and explain what QE is. It is printing money to buy bonds. And the governor said that their preference is to buy government bonds, either federal or state government bonds in the secondary market, so not private sector assets yet. But the basic premise is you buy these bonds at elevated prices to drive interest rates down. And once you buy that, The question is, well, how do you get rid of these bonds? How do you sell them? And the reality is you can't sell them because there's insufficient private sector demand, and that's where you've got to buy them in the first place. So if you did try to sell them in the market, they'd be at lower prices. They'd be, you know, and the central bank would take a loss. And the central banks are not willing to take a loss on these bonds because they probably don't have the capital reserves to actually handle those losses, and therefore that's why you know whether it's the Europeans, whether it's the Americans, or whether it's the Japanese, for example, you know, once you start this QE, it gets out of control, and these QE, these balance sheets are just continuing to expand to astronomical proportions.
Right. So, and just to be clear, you know, the government issues bonds, the RBA basically buy those bonds, so it's the government buying and selling, right? Just two arms of government, effectively, right?
Yes.
And so the boat rises on both sides because the balance sheets get bigger and bigger and bigger. But the question is, how do you unwind it, right? The second point is that he was very clear that they wouldn't buy securitized mortgage pools and they wouldn't buy other types of bonds. Now, there'll be a lot of very filthy investors out there who were expecting that QE would include those types of assets. So I think that's a really interesting observation too.
Although on that point, he said that they have no appetite for it. Mm. But then obviously when Pusher says if we have to, if there's a problem with the residential mortgage-backed security market, we'll intervene in that. So I don't think that, you know, for some of our nemesis who are involved in that market, they may be, you know, missing out initially. But if things go south, you know, they'll be rewarded from their buddies at the RBA.
And they'll probably be pushing the RBA behind the scenes to say, well, you should include this in the scheme of things too. But I thought it was quite an interesting observation, nevertheless.
Yes, yes. But you know, look. But the interesting, obviously, thing is that, you know, if we say that there's a, you know, there's a debt bubble, and we said, look, a couple of months ago when we did a post and we said that the debt bubble is falling apart and we're seeing all sorts of metrics, and even your post today on Walk the World around the construction sector, there's more evidence that the real economy is weakening. Well, what is the solution from the RBA? It's more debt. Mm. You know, it's more printing, it's more debt. You know, they just have to feed the beast because they don't want to face the consequences of a debt bubble, you know, of this proportion collapsing because of what that actually means.
Yeah, and so essentially QE is supporting the financial system and, you know, to be honest, supporting the banks and the bankers, right, but not actually necessarily helping the real economy. In fact, most people would say this is not benefiting the real economy at all, right?
Yeah.
That's a really important point to make because essentially it's not going to solve the fundamental economic issues that actually we face in Australia.
Correct, correct. Now probably just to move the conversation forward, there's there was a few things that I thought the RBA governor, like, he didn't address that I think are worth calling out. So obviously, you know, how much QE, so if they start QE, how much are they going to do? Is there a dollar limit? They obviously didn't give any sort of dimensions. I mean, I think one of the major banks in the last few days put out a note to say that a QE program could be in the order of $115 billion. So that's obviously a quite significant amount. And, you know, how much of that would you know how much over what period would that be? That's obviously important detail to know. You know, no detail about how they unwind. And I think they don't know how to unwind. And they're just going to launch into QE. And they're going to expand the balance sheet. And again, you know, there are examples. So this is debt monetization, and there are examples, you know, particularly in some African development countries, where when you start this, it leads to, you know, loss of confidence in the currency, and it could lead to runaway inflation. In some economies where this has been tried, there hasn't been the level of inflation that some of these African countries have had. But definitely, there is a potential for, you know, for a loss of confidence in the currency were this to occur. So that's obviously important. The fact that they can't tell us how this is going to unwind, and how do we actually get to a normal state? So if we go unconventional, how do we ever get back to conventional monetary policy? And how do we actually take monetary policy interest rates to a more healthy level? There is no roadmap, and I think that's quite scary. One of the other things he said was, if we have a global shock like 2008, what's his limit? He didn't say anything about that. And obviously Matt Barry, who's vocal on Twitter, and he said a lot of the points we've been saying. So I think Matt's a viewer. Never met Matt, but you know, he in his question to the RBA governor in the Q&A session, he talked about the IMF paper which we've quoted, which says taking interest rates to -4%. Well, the RBA governor didn't rule out -4%. So you know. He said that it is quite extremely unlikely, but remember in 1995, John Howard said never ever on GST, and we still had a GST. So he didn't say never ever. He said that's extremely unlikely, but if we have to, we're going to go there. How far would interest rates have to go down? He didn't rule out. So we could well be going to -4%. In terms of these interest rates, and if you're trying to escape the banking system because you don't want to pay these interest rates to the commercial banks, if there is this limitation on cash, you are going to be trapped. And again, you know the AFR and others call us conspiracy theories, but no, the conspiracy is really becoming reality, and we can just see it a couple of years before it's really going to bite.
Yeah, and I think there's one other point I'd like to make, John, and that is that he did say that the real trick to try and get the economy firing again is to get businesses to actually invest in things and to essentially, you know, start making the economic engine work. But the point is that the QE model doesn't really actually necessarily make businesses more likely to borrow to invest in good real things, right? What they tend to do if they borrow at very low rates, they'll basically do it to buy back shares and artificially lift their share prices without actually creating any more economic activity.
Yeah.
And that's another point that I think should have been spoken about, because for me, that's the critical question, right? If you are going to stimulate the economy and to try and actually, you know, really address growth and those other things, then you need a path that will actually encourage real economic outcomes from real businesses, not just repricing shares through buybacks.
Totally agree, Martin. One point I'll make as we wrap up this conversation is he has said consistently, and this goes back to a speech he gave last November at the CETA annual dinner, in which he said there needs to be more heavy lifting from quote fiscal policy. So the central bank basically says they can't do it all. And basically we need to effectively abandon the surplus, and we need to dramatically increase federal government spending. He wants it. The RBA governor, you know, wants a significant infrastructure project to keep people employed, to keep the bubble going. But the consequence of this is that while the household sector is perhaps fully tapped out in terms of how much additional debt they can absorb, he wants to expand the debt bubble by getting the federal government in particular, getting them more in debt. And what does that mean? That means for me and my two daughters, we're going to be saddled with debt. That the Parliament has no roadmap in terms of how we're going to pay this back. So before the GFC, Howard left us in net terms about $70 billion in the bank in terms of the federal government balance sheet. Well, I mean, if you look at liabilities, we're north of half a trillion, going up to $750 billion. And now he's saying, Frydenberg, to his credit, he's been saying, well, we need to have a surplus because we need to start paying back down. We need to pay back some of this debt. And now he's saying, fiscal policy has to do more heavy lifting. We need to get it further into debt, because that's the only thing these guys know around in terms of Keynesian economics. So one of the big concerns I have is that when you get these calls for abandoning the surplus, bringing forward infrastructure spending, bringing forward tax cuts, if you own Commonwealth bonds, whether you're a corporation or an overseas investor or a retail investor, how is this Parliament ever going to pay back this debt? There is no plan, and I don't think these guys even care about paying down debt. And I think that's scary for an intergenerational perspective, particularly for not only people like me in my late 30s, but also in terms of my kids and people in their teenage years as well.
Yeah, now there are a bunch of implications, aren't there, John? And I guess this whole point about more debt is coming, which means that the unsustainable bubble is just going to get even more unsustainable, right? And irreversible. And that basically then gets you into those intergenerational issues. As you say, debt's going to be passed down the generations. So that's a big deal.
Of course, of course. So in terms of just wrapping up this conversation, so when I wrote my when I wrote a piece for news.com.au last year, and I said the six pathways to economic Armageddon, I said that this crisis is going to look of one of six ways. Three of them were around deflation, and I said and the prerequisite for that was quantitative tightening and rising interest rates. And obviously, you know, the most prominent example would be what Harry Dent has said in terms of having a depression. And if people remember my interview with him last year, he said, the central banks won't be able to print 100 trillion, 50 trillion, 100 trillion in the next crisis. And there'll be political voices who will stop the central banks. Well, I don't see evidence that anyone's going to stop the central banks either in this country or around the world to print to oblivion. And so if we have quantitative easing, if we have going down to negative interest rates, we're going to have an inflationary crisis. So I had three scenarios around that, whether it was runaway inflation, a global currency crisis, or in terms of stagflation. My big concern is that that's probably those latter scenarios are probably where we're headed towards now. So, and again, when I had the debate against Christopher Joy, I said housing crisis, dollar crisis, it looks like we're going to go towards some sort of dollar crisis, sometime in the future when people lose confidence in the value of our money because we're printing too much. And we obviously did a show last year where we talked about where we explained what fiat currency is and how that's unbacked and what happens when you print too much of it. And it goes back to the core central historical fact. For the last 1,000 years, anytime you have a form of currency that is unbacked, politicians and bureaucrats always print too much of it. It always, people lose confidence in that form of money. It always leads to failure. There has not been one form of fiat currency in world history that has survived. And it looks like that we are going to see the slow death of the dollar up until the point where our foreign creditors lose confidence in our dollar because of all the foreign debt. And then we could well see the scenario that Peter Brain and Ian Manning wrote in Credit Code Red, where we have a problem with the foreign debt because people have lost confidence in our money. So, a currency crisis in one form or another seems to be the pathway we're headed. And that is a scary future because you just have to look at several examples around the world where that's happened, whether it's Venezuela today, Zimbabwe in 2008, Germany 1923, or if you look at Greece or Hungary post-World War II, hyperinflation or runaway inflation, currency failures, that they are just as bad and in some cases worse than having a deflationary depression like Harry Dent has said.
So the interests of the people, they've been betrayed.
Absolutely, yeah. So I think the people have been betrayed. We have a set of elites, some elected, some unelected. They're taking us down a path where I think the country hasn't really gone before, and the consequences, both economic and social, are going to be huge. And I think the next few years it will be, a very ugly and scary place in Australia.
We will continue to stress and emphasise the interests of the people, even if those all around seem to have forgotten.
Absolutely.
John, thanks for your time today.
Thank you.
Martin North, John Adams, in the interest of the people. We'll see you next time.